Hi, Ellen. Hi, Kamara. Oh.
Hi.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath. If you're happy and you know it, say amen.
Amen.
Are you happy to be in the house of the Lord today?
Of course.
Type amen in the chat.
Right there. Type it in the chat. Well, happy Sabbath, everybody over there. So, no, let's do this again. I'm going to wave to you guys.
You
wave back, all right, because we are live. Happy Sabbath to my right. There we go.
Good.
All right. Happy Sabbath to all those on that side.
Happy Sabbath.
All right. You want to deal with the camera?
And happy Sabbath to you over there. Hi. How
there
are
we
ya?
Well, we just want to welcome you to our
online worship experience.
And we are coming to you live from the Mount of
Salem,
the friendly city of
Montego Bay,
and the island of
Jamaica.
Yes, 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 yes. Well, one thing I'm going to say before I declare my name. This week, we were shaken by an earthquake here in Jamaica. Today, brace yourself for a great shake from the Holy Spirit. What do you say?
Amen.
And for the record, I'm Alan Green alongside
Kamara Dixon.
And I am Sashalyn Hay Vorms. Well, before we started, we were singing this song, you know, some trust in chariots, some trust in horses.
Yes.
But you see, we,
all
of us, you and I, we believe and trust in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
And because we did that throughout the course of this week, we are here, live and living. In Jamaica, we say we're there in live and living colors. And for that, we give God all the glory, honor, and praise.
Yes.
And so if you're joining us this morning on YouTube, Facebook, WCCN, Bless TV, right here, in-house, wherever you are watching us from, if you're listening to us, we welcome you in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. Because of our trust in him and our faith, we are here this morning to worship, to give God praises, to adore his name, and to bless someone. Isn't God good?
Amen.
We are so happy to be here. I know that you will have a great day today because we come here with our praises and we are awaiting God's blessing. Wherever you are from, welcome, welcome, and welcome. Kamara.
I'm loving it.
Loving it, my girl.
Sorry, I'm sorry. Listen to me, man. With that welcome, we cannot help but say God is good. All the time, our God is excellent. And if you are hard-pressed this morning, if you are troubled on any side or every side, if you are concerned, if you are tempted, remember this one thing. You are covered by God's grace.
Oh, yes.
You are connected in his hope and his spirit. I'm telling you, may I ask, is going to empower you to face anything that you are going through, and you will be able to go. And so because of that, we have a wonderful program lined up to empower you, you and you, all of you. We have the, come now, you have to help me now, you know.
Oh, the adult Sabbath school lesson review.
Yes, and we have
Inverse.
And we have Grandma and
Heath.
And we have the
14 parishes.
And then we have what?
The sermon.
All right.
And we cannot forget majestical music.
So you see, the package is here, ready to fuel you up, to jazz you up and get you ready. Brace yourselves, for something is about to go down. And so we implore you to share that link. Tell a friend, to tell another friend that something astronomical is happening right here at West Jamaica Conference. Now, before we go over to our praise team, we'll now ask Sash.
Yes. Alan.
To pray for us.
Let us pray. Mighty God, we come before you this morning to give you thanks and praise, Lord. We are grateful for what you have done. We'll forever be indebted to you, Lord, because there's nothing we can do to repay you for your goodness. We are undeserving of your grace and mercy, Lord, but these blessings you continue to bestow upon us. Lord, as we go throughout the rest of the course of today, we ask that you'll continue to empower us, engulf us with your love.
Yes.
Bless those who are listening, and may hearts be closer drawn to you. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Don't forget the Sabbath. The Lord our God has blessed. joy divine. It means of life descending with heavenly beauty shine. Welcome, welcome, ever welcome, blessed Sabbath day. Welcome, welcome, ever welcome, blessed Sabbath day. Keep the Sabbath holy and worship Him today.
And gladness. 383.
Sabbath day of rest by your master, richly blessed. Hymn number 381.
Divine.
Amen, amen, amen. Wherever you are, I'm inviting you to join me as we pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Lord, you're amazing. Father, you are extraordinary. And there's absolutely none like you. Father, at this moment, I do ask that your Holy Spirit will impress upon my minds the right words to say at this moment. Lord, we confess our sins because we know you are faithful and just to forgive us of all unrighteousness. Everything, Lord, we've thought about or have done that dishonored you this week, or even those things we don't want to talk about that we've done this morning, we are intentional to lay them at your feet and to ask you, Lord, to forgive us and cleanse us. Help us not to hide our sins from you. Help us never to develop that habit of hiding our weaknesses, our challenges, our frailties from you. Father, you specialize in restoring your people, for it is your image that will be renewed in us. Hence, you seek after us each time, and you told us that if we do confess these sins, you will cast them into the bottom of the sea. You won't remember them. So help us not to hold ourselves hostage to anything that we have done and to think that you will not love us anymore and you don't want to see us or hear from us. But God, help us to remember that we are to run to that throne of grace to find help when we need it. And we need it now. And so we do ask that you'll empower us and give us that, renew that right spirit within us so that we may represent you. And so, Father, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for all that you've done for us throughout this week. Lord, you've kept us safe from accidents. Many of us have missed it by an inch, but your angels were there to ward off the plan of the enemy to destroy us. Lord, for those who are struggling, you know, they're not sure of how their lives are going to turn out, but you show up, and we are grateful for that this morning. Thank you for being with our students, our teachers. Thank you, Lord, for being with the nurses and the doctors. Thank you so much for showing up for persons, Lord. And for those who are questioning whether or not you're there, may they also remember, God, that your silence does not mean inactivity, but that you are very much present during the test. May we go through our tests and trials, Father, and come out on the other side victorious. Lord, we present this program before you. We present all the participants, the equipment, the entire platform, and those who come to hear a word, that you will bless each heart, that you will prepare them as well, Father God, to receive what you have prepared for them. And so, Lord, I just want to thank you again for hearing our prayer and for what you're going to do through this platform into the lives of others, into the lives of those who will be joining us shortly. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for hearing us. Thank you for chasing us. Thank you for your love again toward us all. In your name we pray with thanksgiving. Amen.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to Family Connections. Dr. Earl, happy to have you again. Dr. Brown Earl from Northern Caribbean University. Welcome to Family Connection, Dr. Earl.
Thank you, Pastor.
We'll be looking on unresolved grief. What is unresolved grief?
Well, Pastor, this is when you experience intense sorrow and pain and loss over a loved one or loved ones. What happens is that individuals are not able to focus on anything else because they're grieving and they don't want to pay attention to the everyday issues of life.
Can persons who are experiencing grief, can they be helped?
Certainly, Pastor. We have what is referred to as grief therapy, and this helps them to process the loss and move through the processes in a healthy way. And so we do have to understand that as they grieve, that intense emptiness and the pain can and will subside, especially if they believe and understand that the Lord has a greater plan for their lives. Over time, they will achieve acceptance, and they will help themselves to adjust to the new reality of the loss. And this integration can really help them to be stronger persons.
How long does grief last for?
Well, unresolved grief lasts longer than usual for the person whose social circle or cultural background is very, very small. The more you have people around you who care about you, your resolution of grief is going to be much easier. And we must remember that as a person grieves, it doesn't take away from their everyday responsibility. So we must keep them active in doing their everyday activities.
Thank you so much, Doctor, for coming on Family Connections. Viewers and listeners, thank you for tuning in. I am Norman Toms saying bye until we meet next time.
When we have in Jesus all our sins and griefs to bear, what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit, oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful, who will all our souls share? Jesus knows of every weakness. I said, take it to the Lord in prayer. Are we weak and heavy laden, cumbered with a load of care? Precious Savior, still a refuge, just take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful, oh, who will all a solo share? Jesus knows of every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Amen, amen. Beautiful selection. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Welcome, everyone, to another study of the Word as we now review our adult Sabbath school lesson. and we are almost at the end of the quarter. As a matter of fact, we're used to having 13 Sabbaths in a quarter, but this quarter we have 14 Sabbaths, and so we are at lesson number 13. And the topic of our lesson this week is waging peace. I am Shauna Newsom-Myrie, and with me on the panel this morning, I have Elder Rodriguez and Elder Popkin, Sister Popkin. So before we get into the word this morning, Sister Popkin, could you pray for us, please?
Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for your continued love toward us. As we come to review the lesson, may your Holy Spirit guide us, give us new thoughts of you, new hope of heaven, draw us closer to you, and fit us for your soon return, for Christ's sake. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Waging peace. We have been studying the book of Ephesians, and we are at chapter 6. This week, our focus is from chapter 6, verses 10 to 20. I'm going to invite you to share with me in the memory text. It says that in all circumstances, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and take on the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. As we went through the lesson this week, we see that Paul paints a picture of an army, an army that is fully armored. Yes, and we'll go through to look at the different components of the armor that the soldiers were wearing for this battle. As we look at the lesson this week, the topic waging peace, I had to go do a research on the word waging, because waging always is significant or synonymous with war. And waging means war. But can we be at war and at peace at the same time? But as we go through the lesson this week, we see that Paul was painting a picture of God's children as an army on a mission. God's soldiers armored and ready to proclaim to the universe a message for him. The message that God brings is peace to this universe, to the people on earth, peace among nations, peace among communities. And as children of God, that's the war that we are called to fight, a war that proclaims the peace of God. And as we look on Sunday's lesson, the church, a unified army. And in a war, you have to work together as an army. You have to work together as one. If you start to work as individual in the army, then you recognize that you'll have problems. You will be easily defeated. And so Paul was here painting the picture that as a church, that we have to be a unified army if we are going to be successful the battlefield. It's not an individual battle that we fight, but that we are to come together as unity. It says that when we are united together, that we are stronger together. And so as a church, we are called to be united, not to be divided, because if we are divided, then we certainly will not be able to stand. But as we look at the different components of the armor of God, this is the Popkin. It speaks about the belt and the breastplate. Let's discuss.
Yes, so in verse 14, he talks about standing firm and having our loins girded with the truth, and of course the breastplate of righteousness. Now, that belt that was in Paul's day a part of the soldier's outfit was functional. It was used to keep loose-fitting garments in place. You couldn't be fighting war and this piece is flying yonder all over the place. So it was functional, but it was also decorative, because it held some pieces in place that, you know, showed off the soldier's rank and all of that. And so that helped him in keeping himself fit. His hands, you know, today we see people using their hands to hold up their pants. He wouldn't have that soldier wouldn't have to do that because the belt helped him there. And so the truth is God's. It is not ours.
That's right.
The truth with which we will have our loins girded is from God, and that is what will help us to stand firm, because we are not filled with fear. We know what we believe, we know who we believe in, and we're standing firm on that premise. Then the other piece was the breastplate of righteousness. And in Paul's day, the breastplate was made from mail, which was interlocking pieces of iron welded together. In my mind, you know, they'd put them together. And so he would put it on, and it would protect his vital body organs. Well, protect him. And so Paul's likening of the breastplate then to the breastplate of righteousness is the righteousness of Christ, holiness, truth, justice, how we treat others and how we live. So I will not treat you well if I am not practicing, if I am not covered with the righteousness of Christ. What I am is what I'm going to demonstrate to you, or else it's going to be a facade and I can only keep it up for so long. But as I imbibe truth, as my loins, my loin is girded with truth, and truth is internalized, it transforms me, and I therefore am covered in Christ's righteousness, and I am able to treat you as another child of God.
Amen, amen. Thank you so much. Ella Rodriguez, talk to us about the shoes. The church wages peace.
The church wages peace. The shoes is very important. The shoe is a protective gear. And in order for us to go on the battlefield, we need to be protected. It also carries the entire body. Without the feet, we can go nowhere. The word says, thy word is truth. It is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our paths. The feet represents righteousness. Hence, it can only carry truth. It can only bring peace. And so as a church, we are called to go, to walk with the word in season and out of season, because our attitudes alone will not do. Because as human beings, we are destined to fail. But when we go with the word of God, when we preach it, when we tell it with love, it brings conviction to people and bring them to Christ. Amen. So we must arm ourselves with the shoe of righteousness so that we can go on God's errand.
Amen, amen, amen. Sister Popkin, the question is asked, how should believers as combatants in the great controversy use the shield, the helmet, and the sword?
Okay, so we are still in the war, and these are some other pieces of the armor that we need to put on. So the shield of, in Paul's day, it was made of wood and a square thing. And when soaked in water, I found it fascinating because I always read it, but I never did a study on the background. When they soaked it in water, it would literally put out, quench those fiery darts that the enemies would throw at them. And so Paul says, put on the shield of faith wherewith you'll be able to quench the fiery darts. And of course, that shield of faith, that shield is God. God is our shield. And we see him literally in the wilderness. Yes. The desert heat, we talk about heat now. They were in the wilderness. God was their shield, protecting them. And then the helmet of salvation, it was made of iron and it covered the head, but they also made other parts to cover the ear and the back of the neck so that the soldier was well protected. Trust in God is our helmet. When we have that trust in God, the fear of spiritual powers that are out there will not overwhelm us, but we'll be confident and know that we can withstand anything and anyone simply because God is our refuge. And of course, the sword of the Spirit. The soldier had a two-edged sword, and Paul goes into detail to illustrate that. The sword of the Spirit is the word of God. It is cutting, but at the same time, it is also healing and empowering.
Amen, amen. Thank you so much. In a minute, Elder Rodriguez, tell us as soldiers on the battlefield, how we can practice battlefield prayer.
We must first remember that the battle is not ours. Right. Amen. It is the Lord's.
Amen.
We must remember that without prayer, we can achieve nothing. Amen. Prayer shut the mouths of lions. When you pray, it put food on your table.
Amen.
Prayer win victory. And as you see through the history of victory for Israel, and even within our lives, whenever time we get down on our knees, things does not remain the same. And so back then, they had to practice battlefield prayer. And in our time, we have some battles that we have to fight, that we're not wrestling against flesh or blood, but against principalities and powers in high places. Hence, we need to get some battlefield prayers so that we can be victorious in this time, just as how Israel was victorious back then.
Amen, amen, amen. What a wonderful study of the word we have gone through this morning, reminding us that we are all players on the field. Every single one of us are called to enlist in the army of God. And as we face the battle, the great controversy between good and evil, let us put on the whole armor of God so that we may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, and we look forward to you joining us again next week as we continue to study another wonderful lesson, the final one, Ephesians in the heart. God bless you. Have a wonderful Sabbath.
While the world looks upon me as I struggle along, they say I have nothing, but they are so wrong. In my heart, I'm rejoicing, though I wish they could see. So I thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. There's a roof up above me and a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. So I thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. I know I'm not wealthy, and these clothes, they're not new. I don't have much money, but Lord, I have you. And to me, that's all that matters, though I wish they could see. So I thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. There's a roof up above me and a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. Lord, you gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. So I thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. I know I'm not wealthy, and these clothes, they're not new. I don't have much money, but Lord, I have you. That's all that matters, though I wish they could see. So I thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. There's a roof up above me and a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. So I thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, one and all. It feels so good to be in the house of the Lord. My name is Gabrielle Dennis, and I will be your host for today. We, the children from across West Jamaica Conference, feel blessed to be participating in the West Jamaica Conference online worship experience to share the good news of salvation with the world. Our theme for today is Growing to the Next Level with Jesus. Cheyenne Hines from the Seventh-day Adventist Church Kings will now pray for us, and after which, the Petersfield Children Prayers Team will bless our hearts with some lovely singing.
For giving us this day, and thank you for bringing us safely to this conference as we are about to have a wonderful day. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine.
Welcome back, everyone. Our lesson study guides impact useful knowledge that brings us closer to God each week. Elissa Rai Keda from the Seventh-day Adventist Church Junction will review the kindergarten lesson. Cheyenne and Tashe Hines from the Seventh-day Adventist Church Kings will share the primary lesson study, and the junior lessons will be reviewed by Joshua Smith of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, Alligator Pond. How could I forget about Grandma and Keith? Their dynamic presentation each week teaches us how to be better boys and girls, and I am sure they have an exciting story lined up for us today. So don't move. Right after lesson reviews, we will have the children's story.
The topic of the kindergarten lesson is Bitter Water to Better Water. The memory verse is He will lead them to springs of living water. Revelation 7 verse 17. The message, we thank God for giving us water. The summary of the lesson, the prayer should be overflowing with thanks to God.
The topic of the PowerPoint lesson is Whose side are you on? The context comes to us from Joshua chapters 24 and verses 15, and it says, "But if serving the Lord seem undesirable to you, then choose this day whom you will serve, the God of your ancestors beyond the Euphrates, or the God of your Amorites. But for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." The PowerPoint says, we respond to God's grace by choosing to obey Him every day. The summary. Our decision and choices demonstrate whether we want to follow God or turn away from Him.
The topic of the primary lesson is Final Letter to a Friend.
The memory verse is, "Do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord," taken from 2 Timothy 1, verse 8. The message is, "I worship God when I thank Him for Christian role models."
The summary of this, we worship God when we thank Him for the people who helped us to become God's children.
I haven't seen Keith in a long time. Where is Keith? Keith! Keith!
Yes, Grandma?
Where have you been, Keith?
Grandma, I am doing my homework, Grandma.
You're doing your homework?
Yes, Grandma, I'm doing my homework.
So are you through with it?
Yes, Grandma. Well, I am finished.
Well, which homework did you get now, Keith?
Just look at it, Grandma. Look on this page. Oh, it is well done. Not to mention this one.
Wow.
So my typing is in order. You see all my work done. I am getting there, Grandma.
I am so proud of you, Keith.
Yes, Grandma. I am a good behaving boy, Grandma.
But Keith, I see you have the work well done. And I see it well done. I see some big word over here. I've never seen you type much on the computer, Keith.
I am improving my skill, Grandma.
Wait. Let me see something again, Keith. I see that big word that we always have problem with your spelling. Keith.
It's not a matter about spelling, Grandma. It's about typing the word, Grandma.
Wait one moment, Keith. Because this come like you went on the computer. You know what I realized going on?
But, Grandma,
now?
I have to type on the computer. So that's what I type the word on, Grandma. The computer, Grandma.
Keith, I am old, but I know what is going on.
What are you talking about, Grandma?
That word seems like you took it off the computer when I put it in the artificial intelligence. You put the topic there, and then you get everything. Read it for
Seriously,
me,
Keith. Seriously, Grandma?
Yes, read it for me, Keith.
Grandma, we don't need to go through that now, Grandma.
Listen.
Grandma, it's my work, Grandma.
One moment, Keith. I understand. And you're going to go for your book and you're going to sit and do over that work. Because listen.
Writing, Grandma.
Wait. You have to understand, Keith, nothing is wrong with the artificial intelligence doing the work. But there's a big problem. You know what? When you as a child depend on it to be done, it is slowing you down. You find that you cannot think as you should. You don't develop as you should. So you need to sit down and get your work done so that what? You can improve. And you know what happened to? I know that there are many parents that I need to, you know, go and tell teacher about. Because some of the parents doing their children's work, just like how this has been done. So you
right,
go
Grandma.
For the book, and you're going to sit here and get the work done.
And write everything, Grandma?
Not that you're going to do the homework, Keith.
All right, Grandma.
I don't understand, Keith. He come and show enough, say he has done the work. I have some boys and girls I need to go and talk to. Boys and girls, I know at times you go on the computer to get your work done. And also you're using the artificial intelligence. Listen, please do your work yourself to develop your, you know, learning ability, develop your work. And also parents, you have to also allow the children to do their work. When they get their little art and craft or what they have to do, let them do it themselves so that they can develop. Please, boys and girls, little boys and girls, and bigger boys and girls, remember Grandma wants the best for you.
We will be having a new face to bring us a word from God. The person in question is a young lady of 15 years who attends the Montego Bay High School for Girls. She goes to the Seventh-day Adventist Church, Wales Pond. She believes with all her heart that children can follow God and always be with Him if they put prayer at the forefront of their lives. This young Christian is Sister Renee Shaw. As she comes, I ask that you keep the Lord's love in your heart as you listen to God's message. But before she comes, Jenna Campbell from the New Ramble Sabbath School will sing for us.
Sabbath, everyone. I hope you all are having a blessed day and that the program so far has been a blessing to you all. I thank Gabrielle for that wonderful word of introduction and for Jenna for her song, a blessing in song. Today, I come to you with the topic or the title entitled Children Moving to the Next Level with Jesus. But before I start, I would like to pray. Please, please show reverence. Let us pray. Holy and passionate Father, I ask that your Holy Spirit be with me. I ask that you comfort me and protect all of us. I ask that as I speak, I will speak the truth and I will speak your words, and that everyone here will take it to heart and put it into their lives. I ask for this and more in your holy and precious name. Amen. Now, first of all, I will be talking a short while about two young men from the Bible. Two young men who had a very special connection to God. And this special connection to God helped them through the difficulties in their lives. And I will show you how we can keep moving to the next level with God by looking to these young men as examples. Now, to move up to the next level with God, we need something. Something special. And that something special is the Holy Spirit and a strong relationship with God, our Savior. We as humans have emotions, and they can be fickle, and our feelings can be manipulated, and that is our weakness. But to resist these temptations and the manners of man, we have to be able to resist the forces of evil that will be brought upon us. Now, firstly, let's talk about Joseph. When Joseph was tempted with sleeping with a man's wife, the only reason he resisted was because of God, and better yet, because of the teachings of his youth. We are here, young in mind and young in faith, to build a relationship with God so that we're able to resist earth's influence. So that when you go to the next level with Jesus, we are prepared and we don't fall because we have a strong connection with God and we have developed this almost impenetrable shield, which is the Holy Spirit. Now let's go to Daniel. Daniel's story is a prime example of how building a relationship with God from young can help us to move up with him. Now Daniel did something amazing. He prayed 3 times a day when it was the law that no other God should be prayed to. And yet, what exactly did Daniel do? He prayed, and he prayed without ceasing. That important word, without ceasing. And are we aware of what will happen when we pray without ceasing? Our connection with God will grow. We'll begin to display the characteristics, the godly characteristics displayed and required. And we'll have that impenetrable shield that is simply the Holy Spirit residing within us. Now, in essence, the fact is we need to be prepared to move on to the next level with Jesus and to continue to the new levels we will surely face. Christianity is a journey that never ends. And the important fact is that we need to be prepared. We need to absolutely be prepared. And we absolutely need God and guidance from the people around us. And one thing that we absolutely need is prayer, as was talked about in the adult lesson. Prayer is the most important thing, and we can do nothing without prayer. Now, we need to be prepared for the temptations we face and be knowledgeable enough to speak for God when questioned. As we move to the next level, we also need to know the Bible. We need to be prepared by knowing the Bible and praying and developing that relationship with God. So we need to be prepared to stand up for God, prepared to deal with the trials and the temptations, and prepared to move forward with Jesus. If you, as children and as adults, believe with conviction that we should all ensure that we are all prepared, that we as a people will work hard to move up with God, I ask that you pray with me. Lord our Father, God, I ask that as we heard the message, I ask that even though it was short, that we will take it to heart and realize that every word that you give to us means something and we should input it into our lives. I ask to help us to recognize that without you and without prayer, nothing is possible. To help us recognize that we need to read the Bible to become closer to you and to be able to see the examples in the Bible that we should follow. God, I ask that you be with us this Sabbath and that you comfort us and that you remind us that this day is about you and we should have nothing else on our minds. God, I just ask that you be with us and comfort us and continue to help us to move to the next level with you in your holy name.
Amen.
Amen and amen. And we really want to thank all the children, you know, from across West Jamaica Conference. You know, time and time again, our children are doing a wonderful job for the Lord. And we know that they couldn't have done it by themselves. So we thank the parents and the leaders who are constantly training them. And most of all, we thank God for the work that He has been doing in and through them. And we know that as we go through, we want to encourage our children. We want to encourage them to give their little hearts to the Lord. Encourage them that they will make wise choices. So let us always pray for them. And those who are even watching, let us just continue to, as you type their names in the chat for us to pray for them. I want you to know that, yes, we are praying for the children. Let us pray at this time. Father, which art in heaven, I just want to thank you for just being a loving God, a merciful Savior. I thank you that you are always here with our children. And time again, they are doing, you know, the wonderful work for you. They are doing exploit for you. I pray that you'll continue to take them to the next level. Help them as they study. Help them as they pray, as they sing. They'll be faithful to the end. Help us as parents, as adults, that we will set the examples that they can follow as we follow you. Continue to bless the production team. Continue to bless all of us. And give us a good day today, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Wasn't that a blessing? I am feeling so blessed. We want to say a hearty thank you to Sister Smythe James for inviting us to worship with you all. Thank you, all children, for taking part in the West Jamaica Conference program. Thank you, leaders and parents, for preparing us. Thank you, production team, for the job well done. To our online viewers and in-house congregation, thank you for your support and encouragement. As children of God, let us always be determined to grow with Jesus. I was your host, Gabrielle Dennis, saying goodbye for now and God bless you.
Dead for God's kingdom, since my life He controls. Since I gave my heart to Jesus, the longer I serve Him, the sweeter He grows. The longer I serve Him, the sweeter He grows. The more that I love Him, more love He bestows. Each day's like heaven, my heart overflows. The longer I serve Him, the sweeter He grows. Every need is supplying, plenteous grace He bestows. Now every day my ways gets brighter, the longer I serve Him, yes, the sweeter He grows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. I said, the more that I love him, more love he bestows. Each day's like heaven, oh, my heart overflows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. I say, the longer I serve Jesus, the sweeter he grows. Yeah, the more that I love him, more love he bestows. Each day's like heaven, oh God, my heart overflows. The longer I serve him, yes, the sweeter he grows.
Amen, amen. Happy Sabbath, family. Your Inverse friends are here again to share with you some of the powerful insights that we gained into this week's lesson. Certainly, God has been good, and we praise his name for carrying us through another week. Throughout this quarter, we have been looking at the book of Leviticus. And for this, the second to last lesson in the quarter, we looked at the topic holiness. This morning, we have a Holy Spirit-led group of young people ready to share the insights that God would have led them through studying the Inverse lesson this week. To my far left, we have Sister Toni Ann Patterson. Happy Sabbath, sis.
Happy Sabbath, and it's good being here.
Amen. And then beside her, we have Sister Tamika Hart.
Happy Sabbath, our online viewers and those here with us.
To my right, we have Sister Brittany Bygrave.
Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath.
And I'm your brother in Christ, Brother Brandon Gilbert. So to get us started with this week's lesson, Sister Hart, would you mind praying for us?
Heavenly Father, we give you thanks that we have your word to guide us and to guide our feet as we go through this life. As we share today, we pray that all the online viewers and those here in the auditorium will be blessed and their hearts will be changed for your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. So as I noted before, we've been taking a look at the book of Leviticus. And this morning we're going to take a look at a few verses found in chapter 19. Sister Patterson.
So I'll be reading Leviticus 19, 28 through to 32. You shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead, nor print any marks upon you. I am the Lord. Do not prostitute thy daughter to cause her to be a whore, lest the land fall to whoredom and the land become full of wickedness. You shall keep my Sabbaths and reverence my sanctuary. I am the Lord. Regard not them that have familiar spirits, neither seek after wizards to be defiled by them. I am the Lord your God. Thou shalt rise up before the hoary head and honor the face of the old man and fear thy God. I am the Lord.
Amen. Now, our online friends, we know we never leave you out, so we have a few questions for you this morning. To our friends on Facebook, your question is, what does holiness mean to you? What does holiness mean to you? And to our friends on YouTube, how can holiness positively impact a world crying out for social justice? And for those who don't have the Inverse Quarterly, a reminder that you can always find it at www.inversebible.org. Now, in the intro portion of our lesson this week, we looked at the idea of holiness being both positional and practical. Sister Hart, how does being positionally in Jesus make us holy?
How does it make us holy? God expects us to be holy. When we give our lives to God, we are now set apart to be different. Just as Israel then, God had set them apart to be different and to be an influence over all the world. We, when we give our lives to God, we are supposed to be holy. It means that we are set apart and we act different. We dress different. We talk different. I mean, sometimes I'm a little confused. You know, because sometimes, you know, I make an effort to live by the word of God. And sometimes my counterparts, you know, my Christian friends will say to me, "Why, Tamika, you're going like you're holding anybody?" But I'm just saying that God calls each of us to a high calling. And the next time somebody says to you, "Why are you going on like you're so holy?" Remember, God calls each of us to be set apart, and we are to live a life to a high standard and never be ashamed of that.
Amen, amen. Now, Sister Patterson, what does holiness mean to you as a young person?
You know, Sister Hart touched on my points a bit because, you know, I wanted to make that clear. Being holy, it is not a bad thing because that is an attribute of Christ. And multiple times in Leviticus, he tells us to be holy because he is holy. So whenever someone should say to you, "You're going like you're too holy," we ought not to feel any way. That simply means that the Christ that is within us is shining forth. You know, it is important to make holiness a priority in our lives because when we are holy, as Sister Hart said, we act different, we live different, we'll even think differently. And you know, in 1 Peter 2, verse 9, it tells us that we are an holy nation, a peculiar people that should show forth the praises of God. And just to read a little quotation from Christ Objects Lesson in chapter 3, it says that Christ is waiting with longing desire for the manifestation of himself in his church. When the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people, then he will come to claim us as his own. So Christ is waiting for us to reflect his holy character so that he can come and take us to his heavenly kingdom.
Amen. And Sister Bygrave, Leviticus 19, it seems to show God appearing to show Jesus in relatable ways. Were there any insights you got from that portion of the lesson?
Well, throughout the chapter, we see it shows us how we should live holy lives. And Christ showed us how to do that while he was here on this earth. You know, we learn about keeping the Sabbath day holy, caring for the needy, not being unjust, and so on. And what I really liked about this chapter is that in one way or another, we see the Ten Commandments coming through. And if we know one thing about the Ten Commandments is that it really shows us who Christ is. It's a transcript of his character. So each and every day, we must aim to recommit ourselves to Christ. It's not easy to do. Sometimes I will hear a person say, "The prayer that you prayed yesterday is not enough for today." So from a daily standpoint, we must aim to recommit ourselves to Christ. Don't look to the left, don't look to the right, don't look at what other persons are doing. It's just you and Jesus and focus on him.
Amen. Now, Sister Hart, in Ingest this week, we looked at this theme of sundry holiness. What are a few of the key points you found in that portion of the lesson?
You know, God said in Leviticus 19, it's a wonderful chapter, and I encourage everyone to spend some time going through it in lunchtime. It says that God says, "I am holy, and because I am holy, I expect you to be holy, me to be holy, all of us to be holy." And some of the things he says in this is, you know, it's so practical, it's daily living. He says to us, we should respect our parents. He says, for the rich and the poor, we must not regard them. And one of the highlights for the rich and the poor was that he said to the rich, when you're harvesting, leave the edges alone, don't harvest everything, leave the droppings for persons to pick up. And that says to me today that when I get my salary at the end of a month, I should be leaving something for them and not taking everything for myself. And because of time, we really can't go through all the things that we learned, but it was a wonderful chapter. And I'm going to encourage us that we spend some time reading through Leviticus chapter 19 because it talks about how we treat each other, taking care of the stranger as you would yourself. And we encourage us to look at this text this week, today, and live to the calling that God has asked us to, because we are indeed holy.
Amen, amen. Now, Sister Patterson, the interpret portion of the lesson highlighted some very disputed verses. You mind sharing a few of those key points with us this morning?
So I look at the disputed law, which is, should Christians get tattoos or not? And of course, Christians should get tattoo, but it's the type of tattoo and who will give us that tattoo. Of course, it's the Holy Spirit who is the one who gives us that tattoo. And in 2 Corinthians 3, verse 3, we're told by Paul that clearly you are an epistle of Christ, a letter written by Christ. ministered by us, written not with ink, but by the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of flesh, that is, of the heart. And these things will be far more beneficial to us than the ink we might add to our bodily temple.
Amen. We praise God's name that the tattoo he gives us is writing his law in our hearts. Now, Sister Bygrave, your portion of the lesson, what were some of the highlights that you found?
Well, as Tamika said earlier on, a command was given back in the day that when they were harvesting, that they should leave some behind for the poor. And because of this command, we find later down in the book of Ruth that Boaz heeded to that command. And ultimately from that, we can see Jesus really coming through the lineage of Ruth, because we know that's where Boaz and Ruth met up. Now, when you really think about it, can one only imagine if the persons were selfish? They took everything for themselves. Boaz and Ruth probably wouldn't even meet. So I learned a couple of things from that, in that we must be selfless. Don't try to interfere with God's plan. It won't work. And three, we must always aim to obey. Another thing I got from it is that it spoke about one of the two great commandments, love thy neighbor as thyself. And Jesus showed us that while living here on this earth, to the point where wherever Jesus was, people flocked to him. Left, right, and center, where Jesus was, people were. So we must, at all points in time, aim to live like Christ, because as we know it, our life is the best way we can show the type of person Christ is.
Amen, amen. So even as we would have discussed this lesson this week, let us bear in mind these themes that Christ would have shared with us, and by his grace, continue to live a holy life in him. Sister Bygrave, can you praise the Lord for us?
Let us pray. Our most kind and righteous Heavenly Father, we as your people pause before you this morning, giving you thanks and praise for life, for health, for strength. We are not perfect, but we are most definitely in need of your help. Lord, as we go through today, may we reminisce on what was said and done from morning till now, and may we learn each day to live Christ-like lives. Bless us and keep us. Grant us your peace, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
As I kneel in the darkness, in the middle of the night, Lord, I'm praying for assurance, everything's gonna be all right. Lord, I see another valley, and it's down in front of me. I'm afraid I won't be able, and I'll go down in defeat. But he said, do you remember just where I brought you from? Won't you take a look behind you and see how far you've come? Every time you ask me, didn't I deliver you? So why would you be thinking that I couldn't see you through? Didn't I walk on the water, and I calmed the raging sea? I spoke to the wind, and it hushed and it gave it peace. Didn't I run to your rescue? Didn't I hear you when you called? I walked right beside you just so you wouldn't fall. Didn't I leave all of heaven just to die for your sin? I searched until I found you, and I'll do it all again. Now she's talking to her father in a house that was once a home. She said, my bills are coming due, Lord. 6 days is not that long. She hears a voice so still and low. It said, I moved like that before. And I'll do this little thing, child, and I'll give you so much more. Didn't I walk on the water, and I calmed the raging seas? I spoke to
the wind, and it hushed and it gave you peace. Didn't I run to your rescue? Didn't I hear you when you called? I walked right beside you just so you wouldn't fall. Didn't I leave all of heaven just to die for your sin? I searched until I found you, and I'll do it all again. Didn't I leave all of heaven just to die for your sin? I searched until I found you, and I'll do it all again.
Good morning, everybody. What a joy it is to be celebrating Health Week this week. Today we climax this very special program, Health Week Celebration. And it's my joy to present to you the Health Ministry's Director from Jamaica Union, Dr. Dudley Austin. Welcome, Doc. Good
Thank
to
you.
Have you.
Thank you so much, Pastor Grant. Indeed, God has been good to us. We have been celebrating Health Emphasis Week since last Sunday in the Jamaica Union, and we praise God that all of our conferences are activated, sharing the good news, extending the healing ministry of Jesus, empowering members, folks from the community to embrace a healthy lifestyle. And the theme for this year is I will go, embracing a healthy lifestyle now. That's the qualifier, Dr. Dawkins, embracing a healthy lifestyle now, and we praise God for that. And Doc, we admire your ministry. You have been traveling the entire globe, sharing the good news of salvation, doing medical missionary work. You know, the divine biblical commentator Ellen White says, every member should be a medical missionary, learning the principles of a healthy lifestyle and sharing that with the masses for the master. Doc, briefly, share with us how God has been using you. And I'm sure that you have an appeal to make to all the members of the church in this day and age, because we see that Jesus is about to come, and indeed we want Matthew 24 verse 14 to be fulfilled. Jesus says, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached into all the world for a witness unto all nations. Then shall the end come. Tell us what God has done through you in this brief moment.
You know, it's been my privilege even to be here on this platform. And I take the opportunity to first dispel the myth that you need to have a degree from the University of Miami or the University
That's
of
correct.
West Indies. Or remember now that the ones who God called were fishermen, who through their actions, they were able to bring even people back to life That's through it. The blessings of God. So the first thing to realize is that each and every one of us are called to be a part of God's team. And he tells us in the Bible that he will allow you to lay hands and people will recover. Amen. He will keep you yourself from illnesses. So I want to just share a testimony about, you know, myself and my love. I think I would give credit even to my dad, who was a person who was always going out doing evangelism. And one of the highest moments that I've had is actually being on missionary endeavors with himself and also the rest of my family, my kids, my mom, my brothers, going out. And to let you understand that it's not even what we do that bring healing, it's just the fact that we are there. One of the best testimony I have was I remember being in, I think it was Nicaragua, and a family came up, but it was a little girl who, the mom said she was losing weight. She wasn't eating. And as I'm there and I'm thinking, here it is, you have a child about 10 years old and she's not eating, and you know, you could see it in the mom that she was, you know, distressed, seeing her child, you know, withering away. And so when I examined the child and I was speaking to the child and said, you know, what's going on? Does anything hurt? She pointed to her mouth and says, her mouth hurt. When I looked in her mouth, she had a cavity, a large, decaying tooth that anybody who had that, of course, would not be able to eat. Hot, cold, everything would bother her. And I actually started to get somewhat indignant. I felt a rage to know that here it is, a child had something as a cavity that I really couldn't help. And that was where the attention was not. So I started to speak to the mom in a stern way. How could this happen? And then the mom started to tell me her social issue. She had about 3 or 4 kids. The child's father had died. And so she was struggling. And then I started to realize that the way I was feeling really was not justified because I had not known the full circumstances. Okay. And the treatment for it wasn't so much what I did, but I had to give her. I asked the pastor, does he know any dentist? And he said, yes, there's one that's affiliated with the church and everything. I said, listen, make sure this gets done. And by the next day, he arranged for it, and the child came back in the next night for the crusade. One of the best evangelistic team that I've worked with is Florida Advent Mission, where we both teach, preach at night, and we do medical endeavors during the day. And so, to see the child coming back the next night for, the evangelistic meeting, and at the end of it, giving her life, not only herself, but her mother got baptized.
Praise the Lord.
And when you see that, you realize that the actions that we do, many times as Christians, as Adventists, we focus on people who are like ourselves.
That is it.
Whereas if we go out into the world and actually do what Christ did, you find that Christ healed. Amen. Even when they did not necessarily choose to follow him. He healed 10 and one came back to say thank you. Mm-hmm. I also want to advise those who are, taught in the medical field that, listen, you're advised in the spirit of prophecy that you yourself should be missionaries. You should be the leaders. And so as I leave here today, and I thank you for the opportunity to share, my advice is that if you truly want to follow what Christ did and what he asked you to do, each and every one of you should consider yourself today a medical evangelist.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Doc. I appreciate that. And you mentioned the Florida Advent Mission. They'll be coming to Jamaica in November, praise the Lord, to impact one of our conferences. Indeed, God has been good to us. And we see that as we share the health message, we should understand that it is holistic. And as we close here, we have Dr. Michelle Hamilton, who will share a powerful presentation about it is all connected. She will share with us in a brief moment how we can embrace a healthy lifestyle, seeing the holistic picture, remembering that we're holistic beings. God bless you and enjoy the rest of the Sabbath. Sit back and relax, but don't fall asleep because a very powerful presentation is in store, and we'll be back later in the afternoon for a discussion, Doc, as we look at how we can effect behavior change and share a healthy lifestyle with the multitude for the Master. God bless you.
Praise the Lord.
His Sabbath to you. Well, for this weekend, we have a lot to cover. And our topic is, it's all connected. Yes, it is all connected. You know, there are many things that we experience in life, and we haven't been able to link it, really. And if we were able to, a lot of the things that we experience, we'll be able to get them resolved if we're able to link them with our emotional or our spiritual health. Well, I want to share with you a brief presentation on how important it is for us to understand how our health is linked to different things that we may experience in life, and how each body system actually works to protect the other. And as a result, if we know the connections, we can make better choices. So I'm going to share with you a PowerPoint presentation as we continue this talk. Now, as I said, all that we experience in this life, there's a connection to everything. And for some persons and others, they may not see it so clearly. So I hope that at the end of tonight, you'll be able to see a better connection. So let's start with the very basics. Yes. When last have you gotten a physical exam done? Yes. Or get some blood work done? Most times, we often shun away from getting routine blood tests because we're afraid of the results, or we just don't want to spend the money. But it is important because it gives you vital information about several organ systems. And it is very important for at least once per year that you get this checkup done. For those who have other diseases, then sometimes the doctor may request it every 3 or 6 months. But the importance is that you get a checkup done. Now, let me explain to you a little bit further about the complexity of your body and the various body systems that we have. So we have the nervous system. And I know you know what organs I'm talking about. So starting with the brain, right? Yes, the brain. Then we have the integumentary system. And that's the skin. Yes, the largest organ on our body is our skin. Then we have the respiratory system. And we're all quite familiar with that now. Then we have the digestive system. That's where you take care of your food. And then the excretory system, as you know, that's where the waste comes out. Then we have the skeletal system that we burden to carry load. So that's our bones. Then we have the muscular system, of course, our muscles, right? Then we have the circulatory system that consists of the heart and all the blood vessels. Then the endocrine system. So if you think of your thyroid, yes. Yes, the endocrine system. Then we have reproductive system, and that's why we're all here, because of that system. And then finally, the lymphatic or immune system that protects us from everything. Now, you may not have realized that there are so many because you have not seen them on paper or counted them. And some, for some persons, they pay attention to some organ system more than others. And as a result of that, you know, you may miss signs of diseases as they present themselves as early warning signs and symptoms. So it's important for us to understand that all of these systems are interconnected. And as a result of that, you need to take care of them. And you're supposed to be able to pay attention to the changes. Now, how can you do that in a realistic way? Well, let us consider the 6 components of health. Yes, there are 6 components of health. There's the physical health, the mental health, the spiritual health, the emotional health, there's social health, and your environmental health. Now, each one of these areas, it's very important for you to understand that they need to be balanced. So for physical health, we are well known for just linking everything with that, right? So the exercise, the diet, the avoidance of drugs and alcohol, and we want to be free of disease. But our emotional health, how we express ourselves to each other, how we express ourselves in relationships, right? Do you know, how important it is to discuss your feelings, your emotions with someone other than just keeping it to yourself? Yes, it can affect your physical health too. Then your social health. I think we have a better understanding of that now post-COVID. You know, it has to do with the respect for others, the valuing of time spent with each other, and having the ability to actually interact with each other and building healthy relationships. Then we have the mental health, yes? And we understand the importance of addressing that now. So even though we know of mental health conditions like depression and anxiety, what about your self-esteem? Your, you know, how optimistic are you about life? Yeah, do you have a mental illness and are you being treated for it? Do you feel that your treatment is sufficient or is it lacking something? How are you as it relates to how, you know, your family members may treat you from time to time? Make that assessment for yourself. Then we have the spiritual health. And this is very important because this is how we find our sense of purpose in life. Right? This is where we build these morals and these values that helps us to make decisions about the other areas, right? So it's very important for you to factor in these different areas as we look at the complement of systems as it relates to balancing. And then finally, the environmental health, which a lot of persons don't pay much attention to. Yes, your access to clean air, water, but also what's in your environment? What products are you using in your home that is actually harming you? Do you recycle? Do you understand the importance of doing that for the environment and for everyone around? Very important that you pay attention to that as well. So these are the 6 components of health that helps us to live a balanced lifestyle if you pay attention and address each and every one of them. Very important that you do so. Now, as we move along, I want to ask you, do you want to live healthily? I know that you're going to say a resounding yes, irrespective of what platform that you may be on, or if you're directly sitting in the congregation. You want to live healthy. All of us want to do so. But guess what? The desires of the heart and what we do in action is what's going to get us to achieve that. So I want to first, look at your emotions and how they harm your body, right? Because in everything that you experience, you have some emotions that's related to it. Whether it be happiness, anger, joy, you have emotions that's linked to all your experiences. So let's look at the connection between some of these emotions and different body systems. So for example, anger. Anger weakens your liver. Now, the enzymes that are pretty much manned, or the hormones that are regulated by your liver, is very important. So for persons who remain angry, are easily angered, just think about the expression of these hormones, what's happening each time. Yes, the digestive system that we talked about, yes, the liver is part of that, yes. So taking care of your emotional needs and being able to express them is very important. So not saying that you should not get angry, but the Bible tells us be angry and sin not. Now, getting angry is fine, but the problem is staying angry. And too many of us stay angry, and that is the problem. You cannot stay angry. That is not helpful to your body. So we need to resolve conflicts. We need to find different ways to approach things. How we talk to people, how we communicate with others. Very important. Grief. We all at some time face those situations that will cause us to grieve, right? And that has an effect on the lungs, which is a part of the respiratory system. Now, people will say, this is, gone on for too long, you need to move on. And the truth is, there's no set time in terms of when persons should stop grieving. But we know that there are healthy ways in which a person can grieve, and there are unhealthy ways when a person grieves that you need to pay attention to. So some of these unhealthy ways are, if you see someone stop taking care of themselves physically over an extended period of time, they're not keeping themselves clean, not keeping their surroundings clean, they're staying away from persons. And this is an extended time which could be exceed more than 6 months to a year. Then yes, there is need for concern. So that's an unhealthy process of grief that needs addressing. So check yourselves, or if you know someone and you are now able to identify some of these symptoms, then you know that this person would probably need some help and need to speak with a counselor. No worry. Well, this is a big one, because, when we decide to ask God for stuff and we don't get it, we start to worry because we want sometimes things to be instant, and it's not necessarily always so. And a lot of us worry for things that, guess what, it will never, never happen. So why worry when you can pray? Now, it takes a lot of practice because we have a lot of bad habits as it regards to worrying, but it takes practice, and it is possible that you can get this done. So I encourage you to trust God more so that your digestive system can be healthy, because guess what? Your stomach, it affects your stomach. When you worry a lot, you don't digest your food very well. Some persons end up having constipation. Some will have diarrhea. So in essence, when you eat the food and the nutrients that are broken down, what we call the gut microbiome, or the bacteria that lives inside your gut, they're not balanced because of all of this anxiety or worry that you may face. So you don't digest and absorb your nutrients very well from your foods. All right. Then the next one that we want to talk about is stress. No, stress affects every organ, but we're going to focus on the heart and the brain, because do you know that some persons may not suffer from hypertension, and just one stressful life event, and they're not able to cope, to deal with it, and they end up having a heart attack? Yes, stress will kill you. It will kill you. Yes, it will kill you. So you need to be very mindful. If you're in a very stressful environment, if you're in a state of chronic stress, mean that you're in a living situation where you are experiencing stress for several years, that's called chronic stress. That's not good. You need to find a solution. And sometimes it's staring you right in the face. But, at times we just don't want to do the things or make the decisions that are absolutely necessary. So we need to be mindful of this, right? Find coping mechanisms for stress. Pray more. Yes, pray more. Take the time to exercise, very important, because it will help to relieve stress. Focus on ensuring that you maintain good rest time, good sleep, and find other coping mechanisms such as counseling, breathing and relaxation exercise that can help you to deal with the stress. make better decisions, because sometimes some of the stress is caused from the decisions that we make about getting involved in things and taking on too much, too soon, in too short a space of time, and the amount of things that we want to do because we want to achieve. We take on so much and then add this stress to our lives when it could have been avoided. So look at what you are doing in your own life that is adding stress, and that's one layer you can start to peel off from now. All right, then fear. A lot of persons have fear. I know in the past couple of years, we have seen a lot of that, but you have persons who are fearful for everything. Yeah? They're fearful for everything under the sun, and you can't live in fear because fear will weaken the kidneys. Yes? So be mindful of what you're fearful of and pray about it and ask God to help you and trust that he will. Fear not, because he is able to keep and to care. And you know, 3 John 2 reminds us of this. It says, "Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth." Yes, God desires that we prosper and be in good health. And as a result of that, he can heal us in every area of our life. You know, he works in 4 dimensions. Yes, he does. And you know what's so beautiful about it? We have physicians with different specialized skills. Yes, after going to med school for how many years, they then continue to get a specialization. But guess what? We serve the master physician. And you know what's beautiful about this? He has all the skills. So if you have a physical problem and it is caused by an emotional problem, so say, for example, you have unforgiveness in your heart. You have somebody that you're struggling to let go of in terms of a bad relationship or a lot of stress. And as a result of that, you get diagnosed with uncontrolled high blood pressure, or you're having a lot of body aches and pains. Do you know that if you just talk to God, trust him, follow his words, and you are able to let go to heal those broken relationships, do you know that your blood pressure can be stabilized? That all the pain that you have in your body that's caused from inflammation, all of this anxiety that you're feeling because of this emotional situation, do you know all of that will go away? Yes, even if it's a mental problem that you have that was caused from an emotional hurt, for some reason, somewhere along your lifetime, or some physical trauma that you experience that's causing mental anguish. And even so, peradventure, that it's a bad attitude that you have, yes? Or a bad habit that you have that is causing this mental anguish that you're experiencing. Guess what? God can fix that too. Yes, he can. He definitely can fix that too. And then the spiritual, sometimes all of what is happening, the emotional conflicts, the physical conflicts, and the mental issues is caused from the spiritual life not being balanced, not being truth, not living up to the word of God, not having that relationship, not growing in Christ, and everything else is out of whack. Have you ever met those persons who used to walk with Christ, and when they would have left the church, and it may appear that they're fine, and you talk with them, you realize they're going through so much stress and they don't even realize because they have drifted? But guess what? You don't have to leave the church. They can be right inside the church and be far away from God. And all of these things are happening. The physical diagnosis, the emotional turmoil, and the mental anguish. So yes, all areas, God can heal in all dimensions. So why don't you try him? He's the master physician. He can do all things, and he desires for us to be healthy. Now it says in A Call to Stand Apart, the body is the most important medium through which the mind and the soul are developed for the upbuilding of character. Hence, it is that the adversary of souls directs his temptations to the enfeebling and degrading of the physical powers. This is powerful. It means that, you know, the devil works in these areas, right, on the body, make you sick so that your mind will become weak, because he understands what will happen if that should be a possibility. Another quote that I like is found in Last Day Events, where it says, "I saw a time of trouble was before us when stern necessity will compel the people of God to live on bread and water. In the time of trouble, none will labor with their hands. Their sufferings will be mental, and God will provide food for them." Yes? That means there's a time that is coming that you won't get this opportunity. to make these decisions to improve your health and to deal with all of these things, you better be ready, because it says that no matter how you prepare, so if you're preparing to have the farm and to plant all these things, you need to do that now so that you can take better care of your health and afford the food that you want to eat healthy. Because when this time comes, those who are out there who are looking for food, will come and raid your garden, will raid your farm. So you need to prepare the body now, because God says that in that time you won't be able to store up, because he will be the one to feed you. But get the garden now, get the farm now, do all of these things, get the home in the country to prepare your body so you're able to afford to take care of yourself, and then leave the rest to God. It also says, then will be the time for us to trust wholly in God, and he will sustain us. I saw that our bread and water will be sure at that time, and that we shall not lack or suffer hunger, for God is able to spread a table for us in the wilderness. And I say, amen. If necessary, he would even send ravens to feed us, as he did feed Elijah, or even rain manna from heaven, as he did for the Israelites. And I say amen. I say amen to that, you know, over and over again. So guess what? You're searching for something. I want you to stop searching. As you go through this weekend and we focus on this health emphasis about everlasting health, yes, I want you to focus on stop searching. Stop searching for things that you can make, for quick fixes, for the common cold, for all of that. And allow God to get you to celebrate, right? To celebrate. We have an acronym called celebration, choice, exercise, liquids, air, fresh air. You know the entire acronym. I don't have to spell it out for you. Start living by those principles and celebrate now for health everlasting. God wants us to be healthy. We keep searching, and as we make things, we make one thing that causes another problem. He wants us to be healthy. So understand that it is all connected. Yes, it is all connected. Very important. And I want you to make another commitment for God, to ask for God to do for you what you can't do for yourself, to give you that strength to make the right decision so you can be healthy, that your brain can be developed to make wise decisions and to flee from the devil as it relates to the challenges you have with those habits that prevents you from having a healthy lifestyle. Trust God to take you through, and know that he can keep you, he can restore you, he can heal you.
It's all connected. Every little thing is tied.
For a chain is as strong as the weakest link. Holistic health is a way to
papa. It's all connected. Body, spirit, heart, and mind.
When you put the pieces of the puzzle together,
your health will be so fine.
When you put the pieces of the puzzle together,
your health will be so fine. Yeah.
What a privilege to invite as many as possible, pastors, teachers, young people, students, everyone who can come to the very special digital online conference on September 24, Tech Rev, revolutionizing the gospel through technology, how to deliver the amazing and wonderful privilege we have of sharing the gospel message and the three angels' messages with the core of Christ's righteousness to people all over the world, but especially in Jamaica. So the Jamaican Union and the Communication Department and Youth Department invite you to be part of Tech Rev. And they not only invite you, I do too. God will use you. God bless you in a special way.
Redeemed,
am bought with a price. Jesus has changed my whole life. If anybody asks you just who I am, tell them I am redeemed. Where there was hate, love now abides. Where there was confusion, peace now reigns. I'm walking with Jesus. I'm a child of the King, and it's all because I am redeemed. I'll tell of His favor. I will tell of His love. I'll tell of His goodness. His goodness to me. How He purchased my redemption with His own precious blood. And from sin, I am set free. Oh, I am redeemed. I'm bought with a price. Jesus has changed my whole life. If anybody asks just who I am, tell them I am redeemed. I am redeemed. I'm bought with a price. Jesus has changed my whole life. If anybody asks you just who I am, tell them I am redeemed. Oh, if anybody asks you, oh, just who I am, tell them that I've been set free. Tell them what God has done for me. Tell them, I am redeemed.
Amen. Amen. I am redeemed. How about you? We welcome you to this segment. It's the 14 parishes and the diaspora in praise, prayer, testimony, and thanksgiving. And my testimony continues to be, I am redeemed. So the psalmist in Psalm 16 and verse 8 tells us, I have set the Lord always before me. Because He's at my right hand, I shall not be moved. That's what happens when you are redeemed, immovable, as long as we stay connected. So whether you are in Africa or Asia,
Jamaica
by extension, the Caribbean,
Oceania, Europe, and the Americas.
If you haven't yet done so, set the Lord always before you. And if you have already done so, keep him always before you. Not even the gates of hell will be able to prevail against you. So we give the Lord thanks for his awesome promise-keeping, divine ability and faithfulness toward us. I'd like to say a special shout-out to Wayne Morton over there in New Jersey. Thank you for keeping connected to this platform and to all the viewers. Special shout-out to you. We love you, we appreciate you, and we are grateful for your ongoing support. Remember, just like, share, and subscribe. Over to Sash.
Yes, yes, thank you. Well, my beautiful cousin is celebrating her 23rd birthday today. She's in Atlanta, Georgia. Happy birthday, Shade. Continue to grow in the goodness of Christ. You are beautiful, you're pleasant, and you know all of us here in Jamaica and everywhere else loves you so, so much. Charlene Thorpe Henry is also celebrating her birthday today. My adventure friend right over there in Granville. I want to say happy birthday to you today, Charlene. I hope you enjoy your gift. And LaDonna Worms Gordon. How could I forget? That's my sister-in-law. I call her Chinita Chinata. She celebrated her birthday this week. And I just want to say, well, I know you have had a great day. And my brother-in-law, which is Chinita's brother, Fidel Worms, also celebrated his birthday this week. One was Wednesday and the other was Thursday. We say happy belated birthday to you both. And my very good friend right over there in Orange, Pauline Williams. Her husband is a Septembrite. Her son is a Septembrite. And now today, or well, this week, she also celebrated her birthday. Just want to say happy belated birthday to you all and happy Sabbath. On the matter of trusting God, you know I love to talk about this so much. But in the midst of chaos, those who trust in God will find unwavering confidence in whatever circumstances they are in, to stand firm, to remain steadfast, and to be unshaken. And so this morning, I just want to say to you, remain confident that God will see you through. Have a happy Sabbath.
Thank you, and happy birthday to Melvin Bulgin in the chat. It's over to Camaro.
Thank you, Sister Popkin, and we say amen to that. Well, we just want to say happy Sabbath to all of you who are sitting in here. Happy Sabbath, how are you doing? All right. I don't think you heard me. Happy Sabbath and how no do? All right, sounds like this. I greet you well this morning. And we're sending greetings to our friend as well, Lionel. Hi, Lionel, how are you? Happy Sabbath. May the Lord continue to bless you and keep that smile on your face. All right, just imagine being married for 2 months and then losing a husband, your husband. Tragedy has struck in the home of the Foster and the Samuels family, and we are asking everyone on the platforms this morning and in here to pray for LaToya and her family as they grieve the loss of their friend, their husband, a brother, a father, a friend, as I said before. She needs our support during this time. And to Alethea Allen, my colleague, celebrated her birthday this week, wishing you all the best as you continue to grow in grace and be as impactful as you are. As it relates to the thought on confidence in Christ, that's Psalm 16, verse 8. We know sometimes it's difficult to trust God, but with him as our guide, we can be confident to navigate those unknown territories of our lives. The more we trust in God, the more our confidence in his plans for us will grow. I trust and hope that you will make Jesus your confidant, and his confidence will guide you always. God bless you.
Amen. And as we wrap this up, we continue to praise God for his never-changing love toward us. And of course, as we hold fast to his hand, and let him hold your hand if you feel you're too weak, then we can be immovable. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you. Your goodness continues to run after us. Your love continues to be amazing. Your mercies continue to be new every morning. We are overwhelmed that you could love us, but we are grateful. We thank you. We give ourselves again to you. We pray for those in the chat with various issues. We pray for those who are struggling with spiritual battles, financial, health, marital. We pray for those across our sisterhood, across the world family, in the world, who need to know that Jesus loves and saves and is coming soon, who needs to be reminded that they are not alone because you have promised you will never leave or forsake us. So we claim again your promise. We ask that you will continue to be our strength for today and our hope for tomorrow, for Christ's sake. Amen.
And in a world where information travels at the speed of light and attention spans seems to grow shorter by the minute, the ability to convey a powerful message in a concise format is truly an art form. Short films have emerged as a compelling medium for storytelling. Our conference, The Power of Brevity, celebrates these captivating narratives. Whether you are an aspiring filmmaker, a seasoned director, a writer, this presentation promises to inspire, educate, and ignite your creative spark. So please save the date and join us for The Power of Brevity, crafting impactful short films.
I don't know about you, but some of the sweetest fruits that I love is a sugar cane. Nice, big, juicy, chewy mango. But even though those I love are nice, OTEZ apple, they are nice and sweet, there's nothing as sweet as the name of Jesus. His name gets sweeter as the days go by. We put together a medley of songs called the Sweeter Medley. Join us in singing, Sweeter as the Days Go By.
The more I trust him, the more I love him. Nothing good for me to deny. The longer I know him, the better I can show him. I couldn't stop now if I tried. Oh, he gets sweeter as the days go by. He gets sweeter as the moments fly. His love is richer, deeper, fuller, sweeter, 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 sweeter as the days go by.
Mansion. He's perfect.
sunshine and laughter and joy ever after.
Yes,
as we march from the walls of Jasper to see Jesus face to face. Oh, how sweet to rest in the arms of Jesus.
Oh, how sweet.
Oh, how
shall
sweet
you know,
to know I'm saved from all harm. Just to know He has saved me with His mercy, forgave me. Oh, how sweet to lean on Jesus so much. Oh, how sweet to rest in the arms of Jesus. Oh, how sweet to know.
Here, say amen. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above Him there's no other. Why? Because Jesus is the way. John is singing these two songs.
Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above Him there's no other. Jesus is I'm
It is our divine worship service, and I call to attention the parishes of Hanover, Westmoreland, St. James, and St. Elizabeth to give particular attention to these notices, announcements, pieces of information. So we mourn with the Marchtown Church community the passing of Elder Reginald Brown. He one of the longest serving elders at the Seventh-day Adventist Church right there in Marchtown, and gave committed service to God and to his church. He was also a colporteur, and it is our prayer that the fond memories, the influence he had and his commitment will continue to inspire and even to comfort his family, and of course, the church community. Of course, we will be updated with the funeral service time as it is available. The women's ministry's retreat, and that will be northeast, that's from the USA, and of course, North Jamaica Conference and West Jamaica Conference will be held October 26th through to 29. And of course, next Sabbath, final Sabbath in September, we'll have our in-gathering launch conference-wide when we will blanket the conference. And of course, the launch will be in the afternoon, but we'll have speakers in the morning. And of course, we'll do that in 8 zones. And by now, you should have received the information on where your church, your zone will meet for this in-gathering launch. And speaking about blanket, our gratitude is immeasurable to the team of pastors, leaders, and ministers from the Florida Conference who have blanketed the basin, that's the Montego Bay Basin, since last evening, ministering in 14 of our churches. And of course, on the screen is their personal, thank you to West Jamaica. We want to thank the West Jamaica Conference for welcoming a group of pastors, leaders, and ministers from Florida Conference who will preach the word of God and minister. And that's to children at 14 churches starting tonight. That was last night. Remember I told you on the platform last night we are having a Florida treat. So, of course, they gave their experience. First, they began with a visit to headquarters where we expressed appreciation with a donation for conference development. We are certainly immeasurably grateful. And, of course, they ask that we all keep the preachers, churches, and members in prayer that the Lord might work in their lives this Sabbath. So they are right now, as we speak, in those 14 congregations, and there you have a picture of taken yesterday, and of course it was a heartwarming time to have welcomed those leaders from Florida Conference. We are indeed truly, truly grateful. So today we have come again, and we are so delighted to welcome you in-house. We are glad you are here, for we would see so much metal. And thank you for coming. We welcome you online, Facebook, YouTube, WCCN, Bless TV, Instagram, the Deaf community. Thank you for joining us. We are so happy that you are with us. And remember to like, to share, to subscribe. And that subscription is free of cost to you. So, and no charge at all, so remember to subscribe. And of course, remember to send the link. Be the minister and send the link to someone who might very well be the beneficiary of God's grace through your ministry by sending the link. We'd like to specially acknowledge also today in our presence, Pastor Astor Bowers, Dr. Astor Bowers, recently retired. He's worshiping with us. And of course, you saw Dr. Dawkins last night. And earlier this morning, we acknowledge his presence and his brother with him. And all of those, all of you who have come to worship with us. We have a word today from the Lord, and we have a servant of God to deliver that word. He is Pastor Milton Gregory. He is interim dean of the School of Religion and Theology right there at Northern Caribbean University. And of course, he is a man of God. A very godly man, inspiring in his presentation. And of course, he loves the Lord. He loves people. He has done exploits for the Lord. He has served the church, the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Jamaica, and of course, overseas too. He has served there as president, departmental director, pastor, and he is going to be ministering to us today. I invite you to pray for this man of God as he comes. He's not alone, no, not at all. His wife, Gloria, Dr. Gloria Gregory, is here with him, and we welcome you. Welcome you very much to this, the West Jamaica Conference Online Worship Service. And as he ministers today, may our hearts be closer drawn to Jesus. May we be better prepared for his coming. Of course, one of the roles Pastor Dr. Gregory held was Health Ministries Director for the Jamaica Union Conference. So he's no stranger to health. Yes, we are celebrating Health Week. This is the culmination of that celebration, so he will speak to us. He will come at the appropriate time, and before he comes, we will have the scheduled activities. We are going to be singing our hymn of praise, and of course, we will invite you to stand at the appropriate time for that song as we worship the Lord with gladness. And of course, our special hymn is Come, Christians, Join to Sing, Hallelujah, Amen. It's number 10 from the Seventh-day Adventist hymnal.
Come, Christians, join to sing, Hallelujah, Amen. Loud praise to Christ our King, Hallelujah, Amen. Let all with hearts and voice before his throne rejoice. Praise is his gracious choice, Hallelujah. Never end. Hallelujah, Amen.
we continue to worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness, and what an experience we have been having from morning on until now. This is the moment when all of us, brothers and sisters, whether you are in the house or you're online, can participate. Of course, worship is literally incomplete without giving. And we are at the point, we have come to the moment when all of us can give to the cause of God. And I'm sure you are in agreement with me when I say, truly the Lord is blessing us. We are reminded by the wise man in the book of Proverbs, Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 9 in particular, where the text says, honor the Lord with thy substance, and with the first fruits of all thine increase. So shall thy barns be filled with plenty, and thy presses shall burst out with new wine. And so that's Proverbs 3, verses 9 and 10. What a beautiful reminder it is for us today that if we give according to the will of God, He will bless us indeed. It did not say that our presses shall burst out with just a few or old wine, but with new wine. God is always in the business of blessing His people. And so as you consider what God would have done for you today, how He would have taken you from a low place to a high place, this is a moment when you can truly say to Him, Lord, all that I have is yours. And so the ushers are standing by. I'm inviting everyone to give accordingly. And of course, the Lord will bless us and reward us greatly. Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, for your amazing grace. May you bless us richly today as we give. In Jesus' name, amen.
Once I went walking down the long, lonely road, I thought I had no one who'd share my heavy load. Then my mind went soaring back to that place I've never been. And I realized that I was standing at the foot of my King. There were three lonely crosses on the hillside that day. And as I looked at my Savior, I cried, Lord, take me away. There was blood flowing down, and thorns pierced his head. But he cried, Father, forgive. And then my Savior was dead. Well, I stood there in silence, thinking, Lord, how can this be? That your beloved son, he gave his life just for me. Then I heard a sweet voice whisper, child, lift up your head. For the one that you see hanging there, well, Jesus, he's not dead. He's alive, he's alive. Oh, death could not hold him. He's alive, he's alive. Oh, the stone, it was rolled away. See, Satan thought he won the battle when Jesus died on that tree. But Jesus came back from the grave and he won the victory. He's alive, he's alive. No death could not hold him. He's alive, he's alive. Oh, the stone, it was rolled away. See, Satan thought he'd won the battle when Jesus died on that tree. Jesus came back from the grave and he won the victory. Jesus came back from the grave and he won the victory. He is alive.
Amen. It's time for prayer. So I'm inviting those in the congregation here, face to face, to stand. And those of you who are watching from whom, I suggest you get into the attitude of prayer, whatever that is. Let us pray. Our God and our Father, we just praise your name for the marvelous God that you are. You are our creator. You are our sustainer. You are our redeemer. You are the one who keeps us going from day to day. And in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, who has become our Savior, we approach your throne of grace again today. And we are happy that you are never going to get tired of hearing from us. As a matter of fact, Lord, you have invited us to come boldly to the throne of grace, because there is the only place we can find mercy and grace to help in this great time of need. All around us, there are various challenges impacting us. But we thank you for Jesus, through whom we have this unlimited access, and through whom all the resources of heaven are available to us. We ask you to forgive us of our sins. We have come short, and we fail you. We let you down. We misrepresent you so many times, but your mercies endure forever. And Lord, you have said in your words that those who come to you, you will in no wise cast out. We thank you for facilitating this program today. We are living in a time when sicknesses and diseases are increasing at an alarming rate. But you have declared in your word through your servant John that you wish above all things that we may prosper and be in health, even as our souls prosper. We want to thank you for the very comprehensive health program, health message that you have given to your remnant people. It is one that is to help us physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. And we know, Lord, that what you have given to us is the best. Nothing that human beings have devised can equal to or surpass that which you have given to us, your children. But Lord, the reality is that all over the world, so little attention is given to this crucial aspect of the message, so that we are still suffering in areas where we should not be. But again, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercies. We thank you for your patience. So, you have provided men to lift up their voices and to show us our shortcomings and to challenge us to embrace that which you have given to us. And in a little while, your servant will stand up to speak. I pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will take charge of his whole being. You will give him words. You will give him the facility to speak clearly and plainly. And your Holy Spirit will minister to every heart that will be giving attention, that will be listening to this message today, so that it will facilitate the transformation that all of us need. So bless every person present here in the auditorium. Bless all the viewers online. Remember, believers everywhere, give us a sense of the times in which we live and of our great need, and help us to seek you wholeheartedly so that you will be able to fulfill your promise to us. Do for us, Lord, even more than we are able to ask of you today. So much so that when time changes to eternity, and sickness and sorrow and pain will forever be gone, all of us will have the joy of spending eternity with you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Faith is just believing. Others say it's self-deceiving. When in childish dreams to get us through. Deep inside me there's a yearning for true wisdom, not just learning. I trade all my clever question for an answer that is true. I do believe you are the one, the home I've loved. My only hope, God's only Son. I do believe, I touch, I see, that all alone you belong to be. My Lord, my God, Lord, you know I need some answers. Questions eat at me like cancer. Make me once again a simple child. Help me take the risk of losing. Lose it all to find to believe you are the answer. Earth and heaven reconcile. I do believe you are the one, the home I belong to find. My only hope, God's only Son.
such I see that all alone you belong to me. I do believe you are the one, the home I long to find, my only hope, God's only son. I do believe, I touch, I see.
What a wonderful song we've had. I do believe, I still believe that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. And we as his servants, we come to serve him in spirit and in truth today. So happy to join in the West Conference today and those online. Delighted to know that the God we serve is still alive and well. I bring you greetings on behalf of the president of the Northern Caribbean University, Dr. Lincoln Edwards, faculty, staff, and student, and also on behalf of my beloved wife, Gloria, who is right here with me, traveling as usual, keeping me company, and keeping me alert, and keeping me looking good, so I can still present God's word to God's people. We live in a time that people are afraid to stand up for what they believe in. And unfortunately, the Adventist church seemed to find themselves in that particular challenge, whereby they seem not to understand who they are, what they should stand for, and how to live as God wants them to live. So the theme we have today is, I will go, embracing a healthy lifestyle, not later, not tomorrow, but now. Let's bow our heads as we pray. God of our fathers, we come in your presence again to present your word. A word that is able to enlighten us. A word that can give us courage and hope and to fit us for your kingdom. Tabernacle with us now. Bless the people who are here in this place. Be those online, wherever they may be. Let your spirit take full control of everything. And may you have the honor and the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let me take you back to centuries ago. Daniel chapter 1. I read in your hearing verses 7 and 8. The Bible said, to them the chief of the eunuchs gave names. He gave Daniel the name Belteshazzar, to Hananiah Shadrach, and to Michael Meshach, and to Azariah Abednego. But Daniel, the Bible says, purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's delicacies, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore, he requested of the chief of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Most of you are quite familiar with the background to this story. Daniel, along with many Israelites, were taken to Babylon as captives after the fall of Judah. They were in a land with a difficult and different culture, which radically different from their biblical convictions and their religious convictions. They were now exposed to what I call a challenge to their faith. It was extremely difficult for them to practice their religious faith. You see, what the king did and his people, they wanted to assimilate them in their culture. So they did a few things. The first thing they did was to bring them into the palace. Let them enjoy the luxury of a high life. Then he got them to understand that they need to learn the language of the Babylonians. He wanted them to understand their own language so they could read their own books, so that he could sort of change them. In other words, then, assimilate them or to indoctrinate them in the ways of the Babylonians. The third thing he did was to change their names that included the names of the Babylonian gods. And the fourth one I want to spend some time with, provided food for them. The food he gave them was from the king's table. In other words, then, whatever the king was eating, he wanted Daniel and his friends to partake of them. It is important for us to understand that the biblical text seemed to suggest that the food given to Daniel and his friends was a portion of the food prepared for the king himself, the best Babylon had to offer. The king's food and drink may have included, at that point in time, unclean food type. In proper preparation, contact with the dead, other impure objects, and there were sacrifices for the gods are poured out to their idols. However, Daniel and his friends emphatically rejected the king's offer and went to extreme measures to protect themselves from defilement. In doing this, they were showing their resistance to assimilating to the Babylonian culture. I want you all to notice this, that there were no biblical evidence of public display of resistance to them, to their admission to the University of Babylon, to the name change, to the language, to the books that they got, or the education that they were getting. So the question one needs to ask is, why did they not rebel? Why they did not say anything at all about those three things apart from the fourth, which had to do with food? You see, friends, brothers and sisters, the education at home and the temple service they had in Judea prepared them to filter the education, to filter the knowledge, to understand that even though they changed their names to their gods, it could not change their belief in the God who was the only true God. Their preparation did that for them. However, the food, it was different, and I want you to understand this. The food was a different ball game. What am I talking about? It was an external activity. According to Elder Pastor Manuel Rod Rickards, former director of the Biblical Institute for the Adventist Church, he says, looking at this decision not to eat the food from a cultural point of view, we realize that the king's intention was deeper than just eating food. Food determines identity. Food determines your culture. Food determines one's religious convictions. Therefore, the emphasis on food was a part of the cultural and religious attempt to assimilate the Hebrews into Babylonian religion and culture. Hence, these individuals said, hey, we will not deny our culture. We will not deny our identity. We will not deny our religious conviction. We'll rather starve if that's will be. We want to stand up for what we know is right. We will not eat from the king's table. We want something different. What a stand they took. They were now embracing a healthy lifestyle. That's what it was. Because your lifestyle tells exactly who you are. So Daniel and his three friends realized, yes, you could change my name. Yes, you can give me your books. You can tell me what you want to tell me about your doctrines. But I know in whom I believe. I know what I'm standing for. I know what God requires of me. My job, I will not betray my culture. I will not betray my God. I will not betray my religious conviction. I want my lifestyle to testify to all the heathen that the God I serve is a great God. We who are here today as Seventh-day Adventists, we have a different culture from the world. A different culture from the world. Our lifestyle ought to be different. Our diet is different. Our dress is different. Our general deportment ought to be different from the world. But unfortunately, I say it again, unfortunately, Pastor Hussein, too many Seventh-day Adventists don't understand the Adventist culture. Too many of us have forgotten where we are coming from. Too many of us don't understand that our lifestyle is important to witness to men and women who don't know God. So when I eat in public, I must tell people who I am. I am a child of God. When I drink something, they need to know that I'm doing it because I love my God and I'm serving Him and I believe in a healthy lifestyle. My lifestyle must tell people that I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. I am different and I'm proud of it. I'm hoping the day will come when we can come to the realization that how we eat, what we eat, what we drink, how we dress, all of these things are witnesses to individuals. So when you pass somebody on the street, by just looking at how you look, they can say that person is different from the rest. We ought to stand out like the Israelites. Amen. Today, the Jews in North America, most of them, put it that way, especially in Brooklyn, they're dressed in black. They're dressed in white. You know why? It's their way of letting people know who they are. When they see that attire, they say, there goes a Jew. I wish to God that when people look at us, they can say, there goes a child of God, a Seventh-day Adventist. Why are we hiding our culture? Why are we afraid to be different? Why we can't stand up for what we believe in terms of a healthy lifestyle? Why are we making mockery of it for some people? When you tell individuals you don't eat something within the church, oh, you're one of those. Yes, I'm one of those who is standing up for the Adventist culture, standing up for my religious conviction, standing up for what God wants me to stand up for, and those who criticize and condemn, that's your problem. I want to be right with my God. Some things are not popular, but some things are right. Let me say it again. Some things are not popular, but some things are what? Right, based on the Bible. As Seventh-day Adventists, we are modern-day reformers. Carrying the reform from the patriarchs, the prophets, Jesus, the apostles, yes, the reformers of the 16th century, Luther, Jerome, and Huss, early Seventh-day Adventists like Joseph Bate, Ellen G. White, and James White, they were like Daniel and his three friends, not afraid or ashamed to be different from the rest of the population. To stand up for a lifestyle, stand up for a teaching, stand up for their conviction to bring honor and glory to their God. Yes, they were criticized. Yes, they were ostracized. Yes, they were ridiculed. Yes, they were persecuted. And even some suffered death. because of their conviction. But what about us today? Why is it we can't embrace a lifestyle that is different from the world? Why we can't stand up to those who want to criticize and ridicule us for the name of God? When you walk and tell people don't drink alcohol, you're standing up for the principle. When you tell them they don't eat, you don't eat pork, you're standing up for the principle. When you tell them you go to bed at a certain hour every night, you're standing up for a principle. And what I like about the Rasta man, the Rasta man is not afraid to tell people who he is. I'll never forget, some years ago, I was on American Airlines, and for some particular reason, I heard a big noise at the back. When I turned around, there was a dread. And the man was vexed. Imagine, you give I and I pork to eat on the plane. Big noise. He wasn't afraid to tell people that, hey, Rasta man, don't eat pork. Rasta man, stand up for the principle. Why is it that we who know what is right, know what is truth, this Adventist church which I belong, no other church has what we have in terms of health principles. But what is happening to us as members of the Adventist church? We are just like the rest of the population. Are you aware that some of the Adventists who adhere to the health principles live 10 to 15 years longer than the general population? It's a lifestyle, but a lifestyle that is filled with energy, a lifestyle that makes you look good, makes you look young and have energy to do emergency things. That's what it is. I have no shame telling anybody right now I am 73 years old. Amen. No shame of it. Why? I am proud of the lifestyle that I practice. It makes you look different. Why don't we conform to what God wants us to do? Beloved friends, let me tell you the truth. Living a healthy lifestyle is a conscious choice that has the potential to transform your life in countless ways. Try it. Try it. It encompasses adopting habits and making choices that promote spiritual development, social relationships, physical well-being, nurture mental health, and create an overall sense of vitality. I'm happy to let you know that when you incorporate key components such as a balanced diet. Now, I can't forget as a child, when I heard about a balanced diet, I'm thinking of which is heavier, a banana or an orange. But that's not what it is. A balanced diet simply means that you're getting the nutrients from the food. Not processed food per se, but going back to a simple principle. And here's the simple principle. The diet we need to feed on is a diet high in fiber, hold it there, low in salt, and low in sugar. If you do that, you'll be surprised to know you'll live healthier and looking better in the long run. So when I say a diet high in fiber, I'm talking about what? A plant-based diet. What is it? A plant-based diet. A diet that is fed nuts, grains, legumes, tuber coming from the what? The soil. If you just incorporate that in your diet, you'll be surprised to know what a difference that can make for your lifestyle. Other thing to do, regular exercise. Man was not made to be stationary. That's why you have legs. That's why you have arms. You were made to what? Move. So the lifestyle that we are promoting as an Adventist church is that you need to eat right, exercise to what? Burn up excess calories. Calories in, calories out. You get a what? A balance. You get a what? A balance. So what's the deal? A simple exercise program encompasses at least 30 to 40 minutes per session between 3 to 5 days per week. We'll hear more about this when you get here this afternoon. Sufficient sleep. 8 hours sleep. And for children, you need to get more hours. I'm alarmed that in today's world, parents allow children to stay up until 12, 1 o'clock. And the age is what? Like about, say, 6 to 10. No way. Let me pause a little. When my girls were growing up, based on age, 8 o'clock. The latest, 10 o'clock, based on age. Why? They need to get sufficient what? Rest. Sleep. So here's the deal. My simple recommendation is this. Cut back on the TV viewing. You don't need it. Cut back on the late hours playing dominoes, etc., etc. Go to bed early. Your best hours of sleep are before 12. So the more hours you get sleep before 12 is the better you'll feel in the morning. But when you go to bed after 12, the REM sleep is gone. So if you want to live healthily, if you want to look good and feel strong, simple recommendation, go to bed before 12. And I don't mean 1 minute before 12 now. So don't play that game with me. I know the deal. I go to bed 1 minute before 12 and I'm all right. No, at least say 3 to 4 hours before. That's the deal. You can do it. 9 o'clock is pretty good for many people. But the fact is, you need what? Sleep. You need what? Rest. Manage stress. Stress can destroy you. We'll talk about that later. And you, once you do these simple things, you can pave the way for a healthier and happier life. So one may ask the question, what are the steps to embrace a healthy lifestyle? Number one, to embrace a healthy lifestyle, start by setting achievable goals. Are you aware that you can lose 1 pound of fat every week? Let me say it again. So let's assume that you are 160 pounds. Okay? But you feel, or you should, based on your height and body mass, that you need to lose a few pounds. You can burn up 1 pound of calorie every week. So you may say that by the end of the month, safeguard, I would like to lose at least 3 to 4 pounds of weight. It can be done. Instead of trying to say, I want to lose 10 pounds this week. Doesn't make sense. Because if you lose it fast and don't try the same thing, it's going to come back on you again. So your job is to set what? Achievable goals. Number one, simple. I want to increase my intake of vegetables by, say, 2 to 3 slices, or should I say, a few ounces then. Let's say 5 ounces then of vegetables per day. You can do that. And let me tell the men, folk, young men, cultivate the desire to eat vegetables. I don't know why men are afraid of vegetables. And don't believe that 1 slice of tomato is the amount you need. No. Need at least what? 1/2 cup of steamed vegetable or 1 cup of what? Raw vegetables. A fruit, 1 mango, 1 ripe banana, that's a serving. Are we together? But we need fruits, we need vegetables, we need protein, and we need carbohydrates. So minerals, vitamins, carbs, and what? Protein. These combine to make what? A healthy diet for the individual. Could I go further by saying that you can tell yourself, oh, okay, I want to increase my physical activity to at least 2 to 3 more days within the week, if you are not doing 5 days. Or I would walk at least 10, 15, 20 minutes, as soon as I'm through eating my lunch or my dinner, as the case may be. These things help to do what? Live longer and increase your lifespan. So here's the next question then. Can a healthy lifestyle prevent chronic diseases? What do you think the answer is? Y-E-S, yes. Studies do show that while a healthy lifestyle cannot guarantee the prevention of all diseases, here's the good news. It significantly reduces the risk of developing chronic conditions such as heart diseases, type 2 diabetes, obesity, and certain cancers. Now, if a healthy lifestyle can help me live free, or at least minimize the risk, why would I not want to engage in it? It is only practical. So if you want to enjoy life at its best, my simple thing is this: embrace a what? A healthy lifestyle. Embracing, my brothers and sisters, a healthy lifestyle is not just a temporary fix, but a long-term commitment to self-care and personal well-being. So you don't just start today and you stop, and then next 2 months, no, we are saying it must be what? Consistent. And to see the result, you must do it as long as you possibly can, as long as you're able. So my simple thing is this: now is the time to embrace a healthy lifestyle and experience the difference. It took Daniel and his friends a few days to demonstrate to the Babylonian in his time the health plan of God. Let me show you the result. Daniel chapter 1, 14 to 16. Hear what the Bible says. So he consented with them, that's a eunuch, in this matter, and tested them for what? 10 days, 10 days. At the end of 10 days, what an amazing thing. At the end of 10 days, not eating from the king's table, not eating from the flesh pot of Babylon, not drinking the strong wine. The Bible says, at the end of 10 days, their features appeared what? Better and fatter in flesh than all the young men who ate the portion from the king's delicacies. Woo! What a difference! And I'm saying, if you want to feel and experience it, try it. Try and go back to the diet I'm talking about. High in fiber, low in fat and salt, and low in what? Sugar. And just watch it along with exercise, managing your stress. I tell you this, when your friends and relatives see you after a long while or a short while, whoa, man, you're looking good. As a praise God, he has been gracious to me. We can do it. We can do it. Or should I say, you must do it as a child of God. Because in doing that, like Daniel, Daniel was demonstrating to the people around that his lifestyle must be what? Different from the rest. It is high time for us as members of God's church to stand up for the health principles. Stand up for what is right. Stand up for the truth and let people know that your lifestyle is a weakness. I have done some crude surveys when I was Health Ministries Director of Jamaica Union. And what I have discovered, that many Seventh-day Adventists have the same problem that the rest of the population. And I ask myself why. When I ask the questions and look at their lifestyle, it was just like that of the world. Yet, for over 100 plus years, when it was not popular, let me say it again, when it was not popular to eat plant-based food, Seventh-day Adventist was promoting it. I remember the days. When I did my master's in public health and went to some institution
and to recommend to them a plant-based diet. In the 80s, they were saying it's not right. You must eat meat. You must eat flesh. However, the tide has turned. And people who are serious about their health are saying, listen, a plant-based diet is the best. And that's all to it. Now, I'm not one to condemn an individual to eat flesh food or whatever it is. But all I can say, it is not the best. Are we together? It is what? Not the best. There are three diets that we can think of in the Adventist Church. We have what is called acceptable. We have what is called unacceptable. And we have that which is called the excellent diet. The acceptable simply means you eat that which the Bible says you ought to eat. If you have to eat flesh food, it gives guidance. Okay. Then unacceptable is that which the Bible condemns, based on Leviticus chapter 11. And then now the pure or the ultimate diet is that which the Bible also recommends and demonstrated, a plant-based diet. Now, if you have the option, which would you rather choose? The optimum or the lower one? Common sense will tell you. If a man offers you three cows, and those of you who are old enough, they offer you a Lada or a Volkswagen. They offer you a Toyota Corolla. And they offer you a Mercedes Benz. Choose one. Which would you rather have? Talk with me. You want the bug? You want the Toyota? Or would you go for the Mercedes? Top of the line. Now for me, I want the best. I want the best. And the best in that line is the what? The Mercedes. And the best in diets for the individual is what? The plant-based diet. So ultimately, if we are reasoning, if we are what? Reasoning logically, the one that best promotes health and protects you from chronic disease is what? The plant-based diet. Ask your doctors. Google it, and you'll see it. But I'm saying, my people are being destroyed, not so much for lack of knowledge, Pastor, but for refusing to accept the knowledge. They know the knowledge. They refuse to what? Embrace it. Let it become a part of your life. It's high time. How should I say? Time come. Time come. Time come for every man and woman to embrace a lifestyle that promotes health, to give you strength, to give you vim, vitality. Am I making sense? So that you can carry out the work of God. That's it. We are here to become what? Missionaries. And God wants us to demonstrate to the entire world what a true Christian can look like in terms of health. Not just to talk about the second coming, but your body is a witness. Am I making sense? Your body, your whole being should testify of God's goodness. So I'm appealing to this body. Now is the time to embrace a healthy lifestyle and experience the difference. The difference in how you move. Difference in how you live. The difference in how you feel. Difference in how you work. And let us understand that when we embrace the health principles, we are not doing anything wrong. We are just telling people, these things are not the best. There's a better way. And the Adventist Church has enough information on this, whereby if you want to get knowledge, you can find it. But finding knowledge and not practicing that knowledge is a waste of time. For too long, we have been promoting it. For too long, we have been writing about it. For too long, we have been preaching about it. For too long, we have been advocating, agitating for it. Now is the time, my brothers and sisters, to embrace a healthy lifestyle. I like what John Clingan says. He says, every human body is destined for eternal glory. I'll read again. Every human body is what? destined for eternal glory, we would do well to take good care of our bodies. We need to treat them wisely and use them well, because God values them so highly. Since our bodies matter so very much, what we do with them matters equally so. Every human body is indeed somebody who ought to use his or her body to bring honor and glory to God. So let me ask you all a simple question as I wrap this up. What is your body saying to people that you meet? Is your body demonstrating that you're giving honor and glory to God? When people see you, can they say, hey, there goes a well-groomed Christian? By his body. Your body is also what? Testifying to the honor and glory of God. So my sympathy is, embrace a healthy lifestyle. One thing all I want to mention, as Seventh-day Adventists, we have a job to do in enlightening the people we come in contact with. All of us, we are what? Witnesses. We are living testimony as to who God is. I don't know why it says, the knowledge that man is to be a temple for God, a habitation for the revealing of his glory, should be the highest incentive to the care and development of our physical powers. Fearfully, she says, and wonderfully has the Creator wrought in the human frame, and he bids us make it our study, understand its needs, and act our part in preserving it from harm and defilement. Just like Daniel and his companions, not willing to defile his body temple, not willing to allow things inside his body to destroy the temple. He was protecting it. Thus, the Bible says, he resolved in his mind that he would not eat from the king's table. He was embracing a healthy lifestyle. I end by asking a simple question. Can you stand up like Daniel and be different? Can you stand up and say, listen, I will not defile myself or my body with the thing that will bring danger to my body? I will instead put only that which is good in my body so that I can give honor and glory to God. I sincerely pray that all of us who are in this room and those who are viewing can embrace a healthy lifestyle and allow God to get the glory, so when people see you, they can know that indeed not only are you an Adventist, but you're a true representative of what the human body looked like and what the human can be in his deportment, in his eating, in his resting, in his exercise, that all of these things put together is to bring honor and glory to God. May God help you that you commit yourself, not tomorrow, but now, to embrace a healthy lifestyle and experience the difference and give God the honor and the glory. God bless and keep you healthy until he comes. Amen.
Hallelujah, I have found. soul, so long as great. Jesus satisfies my longing. Through his blood I now am saved. Feeding on the husk around me till my strength was almost gone. Long my soul for something better, only still to hunger on. Oh,
serve. Satisfies my desire, he satisfies my life, and I ought to make a commitment to this God who's creator and redeemer and savior. As you listen to this song and listen to the message today, can you be like Daniel? The songwriter says, dare to be a Daniel. Dare to what? Stand alone. Dare to have a purpose and dare to make it known. Is it your desire today by God's grace here saying, I want to make a difference in my community. I want to demonstrate to my friends, my family, what a healthy lifestyle looks like and the result of a healthy lifestyle. Yes, it's not easy. There are challenges. And there are some folk who may not agree with you and decide not to do something. But yet you're saying you want God to be honored by your lifestyle. Are you aware that the body is indeed your temple? And if the body is God's temple, then you have to let him live within your temple. And because of that, you ought not to destroy the temple of God. So will you pledge today, wherever you are, in this building, in your car, in your living room, your bedroom, wherever you are, that like Daniel, who resolved in his heart that he wanted to practice a healthy lifestyle and to demonstrate to the Babylonians what a healthy lifestyle looks like, And he warned us that by God's grace, I too, like Daniel, am resolving in my heart that I will not destroy my body, which is the temple of God, and I will do all in my possession to live a healthy lifestyle, not tomorrow, but now, to embrace it and to give honor and glory to God. If that's your desire, won't you raise your hand where you are? Bless the Lord. Those of you online can put it in the chat that you are saying, by God's grace, I want to be like Daniel, cut across the culture and exhibit what God can do through me to let others know what a healthy lifestyle looks like and what it means to practice a healthy lifestyle. Thank God that you're raising your hands and making that commitment. I give God the praise and the honor. Let us now bow our heads as we pray to close. Almighty God and our Father, we give you thanks again for the opportunity to share your words. We thank you for the gospel of your Son, Jesus Christ, which is able to cut across all culture, all barriers, and men and women can embrace him and embrace his lifestyle. We all know the benefits of a healthy lifestyle, oh God, but some of us lack the courage and the will to do it. Give us now the power to overcome all the obstacles and to pledge by your grace, by your power. As of now, we are going to embrace a healthy lifestyle because indeed we are witnesses for your Son, Jesus Christ. Accept our prayers now and empower us to be bold enough to do what is right. Accept our prayers, bless us individually and collectively, and keep us healthy until you come. In Christ's name we pray, amen. God bless you all. Have a pleasant evening. We meet again at 3:12 this afternoon as we continue the discussion.
Well, 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 we just want to thank Pastor Milton Gregory for such potent message. You know why? I am, Kamara, a living testimony of what healthy diet and a healthy lifestyle can do. That can do what a surgery cannot do. It can do what any form of contemporary medicine cannot do. Your food can be your best medicine or your worst drug. You now have to decide what you want to put into your body. And today is just a reminder of what real happiness, how real happiness comes to us. Real happiness comes to us when we are really healthy. And the best way to be healthy is to be mindful of what we put into our bodies, and that is through eating. Well then, yes, powerfully said. Now if you want to live healthy, just lift that hand and say, I want to be healthy.
Yes, I want to be healthy.
I can't hear you.
I want to be healthy.
I still can't hear you. There you go. Oh, I want to be healthy. And by the grace of God, we can be healthy.
Oh, yes.
We will be healthy. Besides, our lifestyle is an indication of our belief system. So let's show to the world that we believe in the living and true God, and he takes interest in our physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual health.
Oh, yes.
Well, if you think today was excellent, if you think that sermon or thought it was powerful, won't you join us back at 3 p.m. as Pastor Milton Gregory, Pastor Hossein, and others will have a powerful Sachelin
presentation,
panel discussion, yes, and presentation about living healthy. We ask that you will share this link at the appropriate time and remember to subscribe so that you know when we have started back. And so on that note, we thank you for joining us. Those who are in-house, you joined us on Facebook, WCCN, Bless TV, where else?
YouTube.
You said and where YouTube? Else? I did.
And everywhere else, Kamara.
The deaf community.
The deaf community,
that's
yes.
It.
Well, join us at 3. You heard. We hope that you'll enjoy a healthy lunch this afternoon.
I will.
Don't eat what I wouldn't. So we'll see you at 3. Until later, we say bye. Bye.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is my privilege to invite you to attend
the great phenomenal digital online conference sponsored by the Youth and Communication Departments of the Jamaica Union Conference, revolutionizing the gospel through technology. All of you are invited, the youth leaders, the communication experts. Remember, this is a digital online conference with a specific difference to reach the majority of people in the shortest possible time. May God bless you, and please come and enjoy and learn and be inspired.